Cathy comes to us from the United Kingdom's National Oceanography Centre, where she studies many facets of jellies, such as reproduction, jellyfish sex, among coast and deep sea jellies, and what this means for those population explosions that are known as jellyfish blooms, which is a term that you're going to hear a lot of. Cathy's expertise has been in great demand back home as she examines the causes and consequences of jellyfish washing up on UK beaches. And you're saying, hey, that's nothing. I saw in San Francisco jellyfish are washing up on the beaches, and in fact, they are. But now I would hope that you would join me in welcoming Cathy Lucas.
I've spent about 20 years working on jellyfish, and my main jellyfish highlights, I think, have been opportunities of doing blue water diving in Bermuda, and also I spent a year in Florida where I was able to study deep sea jellyfish using the submersible over at the Harbour Branch Oceanographic Institution. And there's a little picture of me looking out of one of the portholes when the submersible goes out to about 3,000 feet. So, jellyfish are found throughout the world's oceans, from the tropics to the poles, and from the coast right into the middle of the open ocean. And they're found from the surface down to the deep sea. And often those that are found in the deep sea are red in colour, and many of them produce their own chemical light, which we call bioluminescence. And they use this bioluminescence to either scare off predators or attract mates or attract prey that they might like to capture. Jelly-like animals are ancient animals, and the earliest records are found in fossils of about 500 million years old. And this easily outbeats the dinosaurs that were around on the Earth between 65 and 365 million years ago. Now, jelly-type organisms are found in quite a diversity of different taxa, and it shows that they've been very well adapted to our life on Earth. So, what are jellyfish? Well, they're not fish, but we're going to describe them as simple animals with gelatinous bodies that contains about 95% water. And this is, would compare with humans, we contain about 60% of our body is made up of water. And there are three groups that we're going to talk about. There's the cnidarians, and there are about 12,000 species of those. The ctenophores, there are about 190 species. And finally, we're going to talk about the thaliacians, and there are about 80 species of those. So first of all, the cnidarians. The name cnidarian comes from the Greek word nidos, which means stinging cells, and most cnidarians do sting. They contain the true jellyfish, which is what you're probably most familiar with, as well as the closely related hydromedusae and the siphonophores. And the corals and the sea anemones are also in the same group. They have two body forms, the medusa, which you can see on the left, and the polyp, which we can see on the right here. And many of the true jellyfish alternate between the medusa and the polyp as part of their life cycle. They can be solitary, as you can see on the left, a single medusa, or they can form complex colonies. And I've got an example here on the right of a siphonophore. In between, there's a picture of something that you probably all recognize, the Portuguese man of war. And it looks like a single jellyfish, but in fact it's a complex colony. So it's got this gas-filled float, which is a modified medusa that floats at the surface. And underneath hangs a load of stinging tentacles and different types of polyps that will have a different function, whether it's for feeding or reproduction, hanging underneath, and they're all interconnected, and it basically acts like a single organism. Jellyfish come in all shapes and sizes, and they can be huge. So we've got an example here of the giant Japanese jellyfish, which can be bigger than us. It can be over 6 foot big and weigh up to 400 pounds, which is pretty amazing. There's also the lion's mane jellyfish, which has tentacles that can stretch up to 120 foot long. And then at the other end of the scale, we have little jellyfish that are barely even the size of your little fingernail. The tenophores, or the cone jellies, are a different group of gelatinous organisms. And the word tenophore comes from the word, another Greek word called cone plates. And each of the tenophores has 8 rows of cone-like structures down its body that it beats to swim through the water. They're very similar to the cnidarians. They're very simple organisms with a simple sac-like body. And we have 3 different groups. They eat zooplankton like the cnidarians. And the example on the left has long, sticky tentacles that hang down and wait for small prey items to get caught up in its sticky tentacles, and then it contracts them and puts it into its mouth. Another group down in this corner here of tenophores eats only other tenophores. And this is basically just like a big sack. And it has a huge mouth at one end, and it comes up to other tenophores and swallows them whole. The last group are the Thaliaceans. And this comes from another Greek derivation. It comes after a Greek goddess of festivities and banquets. And these are rather different from the tenophores and the cnidarians in that they're far more complex animals, and in fact they're quite closely related to us in that they have a primitive central nervous system, and they have a heart, a stomach, and muscles, which I've shown on the picture. There are 3 groups: the salps, the pyrozoans, and the dolichoids. And these swim through the water in the open ocean, in the sunlit water, and they filter microscopic plants called phytoplankton out of the water column. And they can either be solitary, as I've shown in this picture here, or they form amazing aggregates and chains of individuals that can be several feet long, and they swim through the open sunlit water in mainly tropical regions. Well, I hope you've enjoyed the start of this presentation this evening, and that you've learned a little bit about what jellyfish are and what their amazing diversity can be, and that I hope you enjoy the rest of your evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Cathy. As you spoke, it occurred to me that journalists